It's now 6:30. We're going to call the meeting to order. Pledge of Allegiance will be led by Bob Heinzelman, followed by the invocation led by Mary Ann Heisel.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Lord, we're here tonight to do the business of the city. Please be with us as we do that. Please give us your guidance, your wisdom, and most of all, compassion. Please help us to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you always. Thank you for the good things you give us, each and every one of us. And thank you for the struggles and adversities too. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. Is this all the citizens to be heard? Okay, Anne-Marie, you're first, and it'll be Kenny Kahn second. If y'all would give your name and a full address, full name and address as you speak.
Good evening, I'm Anne-Marie Marquette at 207 Hunters Branch Street South. I come this evening, I have with me to present to the mayor and council a list of 219 citizens so far who've signed asking that this council continue with the community events that are held and funded here at City Hall, namely the holiday event in December, also the Arbor and Earth Day event, and finally the 4th of July event. We all came together and agree, those of us that sign this, that these events bring our community together and something that we'd like to see continued.
Thank you very much. Would you like to present those? Okay, thank you very much, and I'll receive these and provide these to the city secretary for the records of Shavano Park.
Thank you.
Okay, and Kenny followed by David. David, if you'd be prepared to speak after Kenny, please.
My name's Kenny Kahn, 206 Cliffside. What I want to talk about today was the fact that our bus stops do not have covers, you know, the little shields or whatever. I was driving home one day when we were having that really torrential rain in July, and a young man was standing there at the bus stop. If he'd laid in the bathtub for 30 minutes, he couldn't have been any wetter. And so, you know, I felt really bad, went and got him an umbrella and gave it to him, and when I saw him, he turned around, I saw that it wasn't quite right. I don't know, you know, if there was anything particularly wrong with him, but I just felt really bad for, I knew he was a citizen here. And I know that VIA, for the most part, we're a real cash cow for them. We pay a lot of money for just a few citizens, but obviously those few citizens need to ride the bus. We're a very affluent city. I don't really see any reason why we can't have what San Antonio has, which is the bus covers to protect the citizens while they're waiting. I don't know who pays for that, but considering how much money we pay for so few people just to ride down the street for VIA, you know, should be a thought that they should pay. But I don't know if you're going to do a study on that. I understand it's on the agenda tonight. But it was a concern, and I thought it would be a nice thing for all our citizens to have that do ride the bus. Thank you.
Bill, do you want to give a little bit of a factual background on that?
Well, we did postpone that agenda item till next month. Alderman Simpson's got that on the agenda. But I will say that we have requested, we've been in coordination with VIA for quite some time in regards to that. They have a program that funds that. They're a little bit reluctant on Northwest Military Highway at this point in time to put them because of the lane widening that's going to go on. We have requested one right outside of City Hall, also at De Zavala and Lock Hill Selma, and then Pond Hill and Northwest Military Highway. So, in fact, I'm supposed to have lunch with VIA or have a meeting with them here soon, and they're going to give me an updated status of that.
Thank you, Bill. No, I'm sorry. No. David, followed by Dagny Florine.
David Pierce, 118 Fawn Drive. Mayor, Alderman, how are you all doing? I just noticed on the agenda there's an item 611 about carports, and I just wanted some more information on that. I've looked up some stuff in Austin, and they're having some problems because a lot of carports don't match the architecture of the homes. People are adding doors and sides to them, and they're just putting their detritus in there and storing junk in there. So it's just, I kind of think, and unless you keep a close eye on this kind of thing, it just makes the neighborhood real tacky. You know, I know there's some nice ones, but a lot of them, like me, I have two cars in the garage, but it's a four-car garage, so I need to get rid of a bunch of stuff, you know. So I just like more information on that and people to consider what may happen if you're not careful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David. Dagny, followed by Mary Jane.
Dagny Florine, 111 Post Oak Way. I have three issues related to smart meters I'd like to talk about. First off, last Friday, if you saw it, WOAI News 4 troubleshooters April Molina had a segment about smart meters, particularly related to high electricity bills that people on the north side have received last month. They focused in on two particular individuals, a representative of the problem, a Missy Williams, whose bill almost doubled, and a few neighborhoods over, a Martindale family whose bill wound up at $721 for the month. Both families, their homes are less than 3,000 square feet, and their thermostat was routinely at 80 during the day and 78 at night. That's a problem we don't want here. Ms. Martindale posted on Nextdoor and received 95 comments from neighbors who experienced the same thing, and many have newly installed smart meters. John Moreno, the CPS rep who was interviewed, essentially boiled it down to your new smart meter is working fine. The burden of proof is on you, and CPS Energy suggests you pay for an energy auditor to go to your home and plead your case. Now, we know that once you go over 600 kilowatt hours, you get major surcharges on your bill upwards after you reach 600 kilowatt hours from May through September. Those are peak capacity charge, fuel adjustment charge, regulatory adjustment fee, and that can bump your bill up by 40% or more. What's behind those fees? Do we have any idea? CPS is a publicly owned municipality. Let's tear the curtain back and find out how they're calculating those. The second item has to do with an idea called conditional acceptance. CPS claims that smart meters cause no adverse health effects, no fires, no electrical equipment damage, no privacy, no hacking problems. Let them put their money where their mouth is. Sign a conditional acceptance agreement with the citizens of Shavano Park such that if any of those things happen, they assume full liability. Now, if they won't do that, then you need to be asking some pretty tough questions as to why. Lastly, the relationship between CPS, the City of San Antonio, and the City of Shavano Park. CPS is wholly owned by the citizens of San Antonio. As Shavano Park residents, have no representation on the CPS board. Per the agreement decades ago, CPS provides 14% of its revenue to the City of San Antonio. This year alone, that accounts to $336 million, or 31% of the general fund of the City of San Antonio. That's big money. We're paying into it. We have no representation, and it's time for you to stand up for the citizens of Shavano Park. Let's do what Austin, some people live up in Austin and have Austin Energy did. They got a settlement because they were in the exact same situation that we are in that they had no representation. I like that word, settlement. Thank you.
Thank you.
MJ Smoot, 101 Shavano Drive, Shavano Park resident, of course. So I'll just go down the list. If you could take some notes, I'd appreciate it. On 6.1, I have requested, and I know that that's part of what the executive session was about, the city's authority regarding the CPS installation of smart meters. And what I'm hoping for is a ordinance that requires CPS to only install the meters where they are requested by the citizens. And I'll just go down the list. I've just got a few comments. On 6.4, I support the approval of the compensation study by Stephen Werling, and I'm asking for 100% funding for the firefighters and police this year to bring us up to standard, according to that report. 6.6, I'm supporting the policy to allow citizens to address the council during council meetings. In the past, when Marne was president, which is most of the time I had been here before, if you had spoken on that particular item, then during the agenda item, Marne would allow some input by the person that had spoke on it. So I would like to see that passed so that we can have more of a civil conversation. 6.13, regarding the review of tree trimming permit fees and permit period, as we're having a new tree committee forum with five new members, I wonder and would like to see if maybe some of these things could be done by the tree committee with somebody more information regarding our trees. And then on the consent agenda on 8.12, I would really like to see the December meeting canceled. I think y'all are working too hard, and I'd like to give you the month of December off. Let's go for November and January. We do enough work around here. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Okay, brings us to item 4 on the agenda, council member comments. We'll start with Alan.
Welcome. Glad everybody's here.
Good evening. Thanks so much for coming out tonight.
Bob?
Good evening, and thank you for all your comments tonight.
Michelle? Good evening.
Michelle, you sound very good this evening.
I know. Thank you for coming out. You have been heard, and we will respond. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Brings us to item 5.1, proclamations, commendations, and announcements. Want to recognize, do we have anybody here from the National Payroll Week organization? We don't. Appreciate them. They've been here in the past. I don't believe they're here this year. They have 23,000 members nationwide, and they are the guys that put together the payroll reports that support those of us who receive salaries, make sure that the money makes it there at the end of the day. They manage this organization. Its payroll departments collectively manage $15 billion in compensation annually, managing federal and state laws. Want to commend them, and we will provide them this proclamation by mail. Thank you very much. Item number 5.2, proclamation recognition for induction of our own Rondi Whalen in the 2016 Texas Freshwater Fishing Hall of Fame. Rondi, would you come forward?
That's right. She's writing a book.
And then the final recognition today is we have 5.3. We're going to defer that. Laura is unfortunately unavailable today. She is our distinguished finance director. We have received the distinguished Budget Presentation Award. This is the first time since 2002 that this community has been recognized, and it is because of the hard work and effort of Laura and Bill and the rest of our staff members here in the administration, and I commend them, and we will recognize, we'll deliver this recognition at our next City Council meeting in September. The final item is 5.4, recognition of Curtis Leach, who is our planner, information systems manager, regarding the Scenic City recognition. Curtis, would you come forward? I know that we all take pictures of you, but I'm going to ask Zena to take a picture of Curtis. Shavano Park has been recognized as a scenic city in Texas. The city of Shavano Park is now recognized as a scenic city by the Scenic City Certification Program. The certification is the result of the city's ongoing efforts to protect city property values, maintain and build excellent infrastructure, and enhance the city's image, all while maintaining a rural atmosphere. The Scenic City Certification Program is the first in the United States to incorporate a comprehensive set of model standards for design and development of public roadways and public spaces into one program. Cities apply to the program for rigorous evaluation and scoring of existing municipal standards against the model. Those with the highest evaluation scores can earn certification. And we will be recognizing, we'll be receiving an actual certification on October 6, 2016 at the annual TML conference. Curtis, I want to thank you for your efforts in putting this together for us. We would not have been recognized but for Curtis's efforts. And Curtis, thanks for going out there and getting this for us. Item 6.1, discussion action, city's authority to by ordinance limit the opt-out fee or to require the installation of smart meters under supervision of trained journeymen, linemen, or licensed electricians. Bill?
Just a quick summary. On August 29th, this all started in June when the City Council directed the City Attorney to investigate and prepare a memorandum advising the City Council of its authority to, by ordinance, to limit the smart meter opt-out fee and to require installation of smart meters under the supervision of trained journeyman, lineman, or licensed electrician. So the City Council directed them to prepare a paper associated with that. Also, the City Council directed us to prepare a letter, which we requested a six-month delay. Mayor and I both signed that. We passed that to CPS. CPS did delay, and their current schedule is now the November-December timeframe. So just here before this meeting, the City Attorney provided answers to those legal questions tasked by City Council in the June 25th meeting. We did it in executive committee because of the attorney-client privilege associated with that. So I won't talk any more about that. I will say that coordination has been made with CPS to hold two town halls on the smart grid initiative or the smart meter initiative in September. And those dates are 22nd of September between 6 and 8 p.m., and which is a Thursday, the 24th of September, which is a Saturday between 10 and 12 p.m., both here at City Hall. The format is basically going to be a presentation by CPS Energy with questions then later directed to subject matter experts at tables, which will be set up at City Hall Council Chambers, and there'll be an opportunity to engage and answer a number of questions. CPS also informed me that there are two other community events which may be of interest to citizens of Shavano Park. They title them Energy Saving Road Shows, and they're close proximity to Shavano Park. These sessions provide information on the smart grid initiative, weatherization programs, rebates, demand response, natural gas safety, a lot of other things besides smart meters. Those will be 28 September between 5:30 and 7:30 at the Jewish Community Center, and 13 October between 5:30 and 7:30 at Aggie Park. Again, an opportunity for further questions if that's need be. Anyway, I don't have any further information other than that for summarizing it.
I'm going to entertain a motion to open this up for discussion. Do we have a motion to open this for discussion?
So moved.
Alderman Simpson has made a motion to open it up for discussion. Alderman Allen.
Second.
Alderman Barrier is second in the motion. We are now open for discussion.
Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, Mike.
For the citizens' information, the city manager passed on a conversation that he had in another forum with CPS representatives, indicating that if we did require them to use other than the normal installation personnel, that that would cost them money, and they would be real quick to pass that on to the customer. That's not something that they were prepared to absorb. And so for the citizens out here who are interested, that's one of the an opening gambit by CPS, is that if we take that action, that they're going to pass on any additional cost to the customers. So that's something that I think we all need to take into consideration, and before we do that, get some sort of survey of the citizens to see if a vast majority of the citizen would be willing to absorb that additional cost.
Okay, so Mike, I think the predicate of what you just laid out is the question of, can we ask CPS with any authority to not charge the $20 a month fee? And you know, that the implication of what you just said is they're going to charge the 20%, the $20 fee, and we do not have standing to oppose that $20 fee for the people opting out. Is that
actually? I hadn't brought that up because that was part of the attorney-client discussion. Okay. This was a discussion that the city manager had as far as requiring more skilled personnel than the run-of-the-mill installers to come out, that would cost them more money, and they would be more than happy to pass that on to us.
Okay. Anybody have anything else that they want to discuss? Okay. If we have no further discussion, then we'll go to item 6.2, public hearing. Receive comments from members of the public regarding an application for a proposed drive-through automatic teller machine to be located at Huntington West offices, 3424 Paesanos Way. It is now 6:54. We're going to open the public hearing section. Bill, who is going to be our presenter during the public hearing session?
Well, we do have a representative from Bitterblue that can present, I suppose.
Good evening. I'm Cecilia Garcia, and I am representing Bitterblue Development. Pass those out. Daryl's going to be passing out some information that might help you follow me along with this. We completed construction of a building at 3424 Paesanos Parkway. It's a 52,000 square foot building, and we have an existing tenant in that building that moved in June, and we are doing interior finish out for another tenant, and we've got a couple more in the pipeline, so we're well on our way to a successful building there. Our second tenant in that building, whose finish out we're currently doing, is Lone Star National Bank, and they have requested that we seek approval for an ATM facility that would be located on the exterior of the building. And it's kind of a hybrid, actually. And in your little package that Daryl gave you, the second page shows kind of a rendering of what it might look like. And the intention is that the building would, the ATM facility would look kind of similar to the existing building. And it would, of course, follow all of the criteria that is required for a facility such as that, which would be appropriate lighting. We do have existing cameras throughout the interior and the exterior of the facility that are recorded. And the ATM is, again, kind of like a hybrid in that it's not a traditional drive-through, although it does have vehicular access capabilities, but it sits kind of in an alcove behind the building, so it's really not visible from the street or even 1604. It's in a very nice little alcove behind the building, kind of shaded in a grove of trees. And so in accordance with the zoning that is at that property, which is O1, a bank and savings and loan drive-through facility requires city council approval. Last month, we met with the Planning and Zoning Commission, and they did give us approval for the facility that you see in front of you. And again, it is an existing building. This would aid the tenant that's going into the building very much, and they would like to get your approval on this. Do you have any questions that I might answer?
Well, this is the public hearing section, and so we're going to invite citizens to come forward if they have any questions concerning did I hear you correctly, it's a combination ATM drive-through. Does it include an ATM feature? Or
yes, it does.
It's a combination ATM drive-through for a bank that will be situated in Shavano Park.
That's right.
Okay. Do we have any citizens who would like to address questions to Ms. Garcia? Okay, if we have no citizens, then we're going to call the public hearing section of this meeting to a close. It is now 7:57. Okay, we're going to go to 6.3, Discussion Action Ordinance O-2016-011, approving drive-through automatic teller machine to be located at Huntington West Office Building, 3424 Paesano Parkway. Okay, Bill, do you have anything that you'd like to add for us?
Just to clarify, the property zone in B2, it's a B2 PUD, but so O1 applies to that. And again, Cecilia was correct. Bank savings alone, drive-through facilities require CC approval. So there's criteria established for CC approval. And again, we've presented this to the Planning Zoning Commission. The Planning Zoning Commission shall determine that such uses are harmonious with and adaptable to the buildings, structures, and uses abutting property and other property in the vicinity of the premise under consideration, and shall make recommendations as to the requirements. And it goes on. But Planning and Zoning Commission met. They asked a number of questions, including lighting, drivability, and drive-through, and the directions and so forth. They determined that it was compatible. There is a savings and loan in the building. This is, although it's an ATM, you can walk up to it. It's also a drive-through facility that can be associated with it. So staff's recommendation is to approve Ordinance O-2016-011, approving the drive-through automatic teller machine located at the Huntington Building, Office Building 3424.
Okay. Do we have a motion concerning Ordinance O-2016-011, approving a drive-through automatic teller machine to be located at Huntington West Office Building 3424 Paesano Parkway?
I would move approval of that ordinance.
Okay. We have a motion to approve by Alderman Simpson.
Second.
Alderman Ross has seconded the motion. We're now open for discussion. Is there any discussion? Bob?
So I'm definitely in favor of savings and loan, and I think this council has been very pro-business, but I do have a couple of concerns. And one is safety, and you talked about the location. That area in the Paesanos Parkway or back there in Huntington is typically, we've had some issues with the restaurant, break-ins in cars. We have certainly a little higher crime area than we have in other parts of the city. So bringing a bank and an ATM that stands by itself behind the building, not accessible from, or not that it's not accessible, but not viewable from 1604, just brings me a little concern about the safety. And the other question I would have for Bill and for our police force is to me, that is going to entail some additional patrolling in that particular area, just the fact that we're going to have a bank there with an accessible ATM. And I think that to me seems as though we're going to need to put some more resources, at least patrolling wise, over there. So those are my two concerns.
Okay, Bill, do you want to address them, or do you want Chief Creed to come forward and address them?
Chief Creed can come up and address. I do know we have routine patrols through that area. We do focus on the restaurant. And Chief, do you have anything else to add in terms of the office buildings and so forth?
The particular office building in question is part of our patrol route. It's on the main thoroughfare through that subdivision, Paesanos Parkway, and is essentially wide open. There's not a lot right now that cuts off our view of anything in the parking lot except the building itself, and the whole parking lot is open to us so that we can drive around it. We've had several break-ins there in the area. We are aware of the problems and have taken the normal patrol routes to address those and see if we can't address those properly. Did have a phone call from a lady today that is one of the property managers, and I do not recall her name.
Was that you?
Okay. called to alert us that they'd received a call of a parked vehicle in the parking lot. Vehicle had been there for some time. So apparently the people that are working in the area are aware of the problems that they've been faced with, and they're quick to call. We got down there in time to talk to the individual. Turns out that he was just utilizing a shady spot, take a nap. But it's the interest that we look for in the people that work and live in the area to pay attention to what's going on in the area, and it has proved to be very positive. I don't foresee any particular problems with the patrol routines there in the area. The whole area is building up. We are getting more calls down there, not just from there, but I know that the fire department and EMS have been getting calls at some of the medical facilities down there. With that in place, we have stepped up our patrol in the area. So I don't really see anything that impacts the police department in a negative way. We're completely prepared to address these things as they occur, and hopefully proactively through our patrols.
One other question, Chief. So in the parking lot, you said it's an open parking lot, but as I understand it, it's not viewable from 1604. You can't see it. It's on the back side of the building?
It is the rear parking lot of the property, mm-hmm. And the only reason you can't really see that from 1604 is that the rear part of the property, there actually is kind of an elevation difference, so that parking lot is a little bit lower. You can see the building very well, and it is lit up in accordance with the lighting regulations. But it's just that particular area from 1604, because the landscaping sits up higher, there's kind of a retaining wall. But like the chief was mentioning, along Paesanos Parkway, it's very open, very visible. And the tenants that are there now, and the other tenants that we have in, they actually kind of are flex tenants. So they're in and out of the building virtually at all hours of the day and night. And they are very vigilant. And we've worked with the police department, in terms of making sure that they know us. They do a great job. We're on a nightly patrol. I think everybody in that area knows that, they're very vigilant. But you can see that area very well. It's visible from Paesanos Parkway. It's just, the speed and the way that sits in back, you can't see it. You can see the front of the parking lot very well from 1604.
Okay, thank you. Chief, the types of crimes that are associated with ATM machines, when we were all young, and I'm looking through the through the room, and there are a couple of people like Linda who was young much more recently than the rest of us were, but most of us were not young real recently. There were climes of opportunity where people would sit there waiting on people to come up to ATMs. Do those types of crimes happen that often? I'm not reading them in the paper, and I would appreciate your professional opinion on whether there's something that we need to look at in Shavano Park and say, golly, this is a hornet's nest and we're about to strike it.
The locations that are more problematic, anytime you have people showing up at a location to obtain money, you're going to have the potential for that. The problems that suffer more problems are the ones that are concealed, do not have a good field of view, and one where people are just not paying attention to their surroundings. We've already figured out that the people in this building seem to pay pretty close attention to what's going on out there. The route that the police officers usually take in approaching this particular building is either down Paesanos Parkway, or if they should come down 1604, they can make the loop back onto Paesanos Parkway and come in from that side. Not having the area visible to 1604 does not prove problematic for us. There's good visibility from, straight direct line of sight from Paesanos Parkway to where this location is depicted. Once we get landscaping and other stuff in the area, then it'll just be incumbent upon the officers to drive through more closely patrolling the area, such as we do with Paesanos Restaurant and some of the other places that have a lot of vegetation and landscaping.
Okay. Now, Chief, this is a PUD, and this is a planned unit development area, and so we have the ability in granting exceptions to require specific items, such as modifications to the landscaping plan could require the review and approval by our city manager. Do you know if we have some type of limitations like that to prevent screening that would occur that you would find to be objectionable?
Judging by what I'm seeing here, I don't see anything that's going to be problematic for our patrol purposes. It's one of those things where as the company goes forward in putting together their plans there and putting them into fruition, everybody concerned with the city is pretty attentive to the area and can provide direction either to the builders or to the city manager's office as necessary.
Okay. Does anybody else have any questions for Ms. Garcia or for Chief Creed? Alan?
I don't have a question per se, but this reminds me in concept, even though there's not a bank right there, is the ATM the USAA has at the rim. It's just a freestanding ATM with no bank anywhere near it. So I understand the concept, and I personally don't see a problem with it.
Yeah, and of course, this, Alan, would be conditional upon that a bank goes into this location. We're not offering up
right.
an ATM teller. We're offering up
right.
an ATM for a banking location. And when the banking location disappears, then I'm assuming that we're going to condition the ordinance to require that the ATM come out. Okay, Michelle, do you have any comments? Okay, we have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. The motion carries. Bill, clarification, this is the first CC that we've done since I've been the mayor. Do you record the votes for the CC or not?
I don't believe so.
Okay. I just want to make sure that we're following the protocols that have been followed by City Council previously. Okay. 6.4, discussion action approval of the City of Shavano Park's compensation study. I don't see Steve in the room.
Steve's not in here.
Okay.
There's no new information presented, so I'm just going to summarize this. Again, on the 13th of July, we've been working this for a number of months. 13th of July, Steve Werling presented the compensation report, and in that, there was discussion of of how it was adopted, et cetera. There's been a number of workshops that have occurred. I'll just kind of highlight a bit of that. Further work was done to review the recommendations of the report, revise in order to tailor specifically to Shavano Park. First grade assignments were assigned recommendations for each position and presented on the 19 July workshop. Afterwards, each employee's salary was determined using an individual pay model, which was uniformly calculated based upon predetermined factors, which is mostly prior experience, current experience, and certifications. At the 4 August meeting, the city manager presented the city manager's budget with the recommendation that the study recommendations be fully implemented this year. And that recommendation was based upon the analysis that we could implement this without raising the current tax rate, which again is below the effective tax rate. Again, in August, on August 16th, at a city council budget workshop, Steve Werling presented the individual pay model results, which is the final component of the compensation report. I attached that in the council's packet. Subsequent to that, in fact, just this afternoon, Steve has taken all three reports that you've previously received and combined it into one. There's no new information in here. It basically combines the initial compensation report with the individual pay model, and then the last part of it is the salary study that was included. So this represents the final product associated with this year's compensation study.
Okay. Do we have a motion to approve?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
I would move we approve implementation of the City of Shavano Park compensation study as previously presented, with the exception of the pay for the city manager, which will be determined by a separate city action, council action, as required by the local government code.
Okay, we have a motion to accept to approve the compensation study, striking the city manager's compensation. Do we have a second?
So moved.
Alderman Barrier seconded. Thank you, Alan. Okay, we're now open for discussion. Is there any discussion?
I'm not sure why we would remove putting the money into the budget for the city manager.
The reason that I accepted the city manager is that the local government code 25.026 says that the city manager's compensation is set by a separate ordinance. I'm not advocating that we remove the money from the budget, just that we take the city manager out of the compensation.
I think that what she's saying, Mike, is that it's a part of the study. We're approving the study, and that we'll have a budget ordinance that adopts the budget and adopts the city manager's compensation. And of course, in adopting this, city council has not acted on the budget at this time, and everything can be changed, including the city manager's compensation. And I think that that's what Michelle is saying. Michelle is...
because we had the study done on all the positions, and this includes what information is provided for the city manager's position. So I don't agree with not including that as part of the study, because we asked for that.
Okay. Did you want to make a supplemental motion?
I just had a question. I didn't get that it was accepted from the...
It's to accept it from the report. We're approving the study. That's all we're doing today. We're not adopting it as a part of our budget. The budget has not been adopted.
I guess I didn't hear from the motion that he was taking it out of what we're approving today. It was just making clear that what we're doing with respect to the city manager is done according to the Texas local government code.
And we would always be doing that, though. So
I understand.
Well, I don't want to speak for
to
Alderman Simpson.
Yeah.
I thought your motion was to remove it.
The intent of the exception is that the individual pay model has things that we need to discuss that's separate from the pay schedule or pay philosophy of a normal salaried staff member, because the city manager works for the city council, and the code says we set his his pay by ordinance. I just think we need to talk about him separately.
I'd like to amend the motion to put the city manager's information back into the study and approve it, and then that has nothing to do with our doing his composition and review, which we'll do at a later time.
Okay, we have a motion to amend. Do we have a second on the motion to amend?
I'll second.
Bob has seconded the motion to amend. Do we have any discussion on the motion to amend?
And I don't disagree with the fact that we're going to review him at a later date and decide it, but this is a study, and this is what the facts that we came up with from other organizations, and I think it should be part of the complete package.
So the question is that by adopting this today, we're not making a representation to any employee, whether that employee is the city manager or the fire, the police.
Correct.
Anybody. We're just saying we accept the study?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, we have a motion to amend. We will, Mike, do you accept the amendment as a friendly amendment?
No, sir.
Okay. Then we will, if there's no further discussion on the motion to amend, then we will act on the motion to amend first. All in favor of the motion to amend, which is to accept the study without revision, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Okay, Mike, I believe that takes care of the issue because it's supplanted, it supplemented your motion, and it replaced it in its entirety.
Right, and now we need to vote on the amended motion.
Okay. We have accepted the amendment. Now all in favor of the motion to accept the study as provided, say aye.
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 All opposed, same sign.
Aye.
The motion carries. Okay, item 6.5, discussion presentation, semi-annual development presentation, Bitterblue, Denton Communities. Laddie, who's going to be talking for you first?
Hi. Evening, Mayor.
Daryl, do you want to tell us all your name?
Yes, sir. Hi, Daryl Lang with Bitterblue Development. Good evening.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cecilia.
Now, Daryl, this is entirely the program that we have on our iPads, and it's the handout that you've provided in its entirety with no additional information. Is that correct? The one that our citizens are going to be receiving?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then we will all stay up here if that's okay with everybody. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Curtis. This is an addendum. We gave this a previous presentation to P&Z. And wanted to update you. A lot of activity in this corridor. We're going to start. We're not going to cover every absolute detail. I'm going to cover the corridor starting at Lock Hill Selma. Then we're going to move up near Northwest Military, work our way east over to the Bitters Road, and then we'll come back around north. And we're including some areas that are outside of City of Shavano Park, but they're surrounding your community, so we want you to know what is going on in those areas also. And the first slide here is simply a great location for retail and office. And I'm sure you've been seeing a lot of the development go on. Office has been very well received here, a Class A office. So a very nice office. Cecilia's been handling the leasing for the office. And for example, Lone Star National Bank, you know, well aware, good companies, you know, coming to this area. The aerial view is simply the areas of the corridor I'm going to cover. We don't show Lock Hill Selma, and we're going to get to that next. Lock Hill Selma, we have a couple, you see small office pending and small office sold. These are in, you know, Class A office, 5 to 10,000 square feet, like a garden office where you park up near the front or on the sides and walk in. So we've been very successful with attracting this type of user. It's a very good user across from a neighborhood such as Bentley Manor. It's low impact, you know, it's an 8-to-5 type use. It's just a good use. We have Paramount Healthcare. They should be submitting for, you know, permit any day. That is the skilled nursing facility. that was approved last year or early this year. And then we have approximately three more acres left between 4350 Lock Hill and, you know, Paramount Nursing. And we're working with a couple users on that. Again, Class A garden office, you know, there. We also have the 2 acres right at the end there at De Zavala and Lock Hill, plus or minus 2 acres. We're going through grading plan exercises to see what might, you know, what kind of use could go there.
A bit of a hole.
Yes, and we've had a call from probably about 20 different C-store operators, and I have to inform them they cannot go there. So this is just a little bit more detail on that plus or minus 4 acres between 4350 Lock Hill and, you know, Paramount Nursing Facility. We're going to shoot up to the west side of Northwest Military, and this is what we consider the Pond Hill Commercial. And you can see where we're moving from west to east with office. You have a Class A office for lease. Then you have Bexar County Medical Association. Partners Wealth, that recently conveyed to a new owner. Mm-hmm. So you'll probably be seeing development on that site, you know, very soon. I'm going to go to the next slide just to show a little more detail. That larger building there is James Jaffet Class A office. Building in the middle is Bexar Medical Society, and then Pond Hill office, formerly Partners Wealth, that is an optometrist who purchased that. Okay, so like a eye doctor's office. This part we're working very hard on. This is right on the other side of Pond Hill. We have approximately 1.3 acres of commercial right on that corner that we're not doing anything with right now. We're just sitting on that. And the next area is plus or minus 3 acres, and we're working with Two Bros Barbecue. We're very close. It's a very detailed project with a lot of financials, a lot of details, and we're very close to putting that together with them. And this is going to be a family, you know, family-friendly area. Obviously, barbecue. They do a great business over on West Avenue. They sell a very, very good product. And we think it's going to be a real hit here. We've walked that site. It just fits so very nicely, you know, right there around the tank. And there's some renderings here that we have of it, some elevations. And this is pretty much what it's going to look like, kind of like a little modern, you know, hill country. Definitely a higher end building. So we just threw those in so you can kind of get a idea of what's going in there. Okay, lots of natural material. Pond Hill Drive, I didn't...
Just a quick question. I'm looking at your rendering. Is this all stucco exterior? Is that what this is?
Actually, it's a rock.
Okay, rock, because some of it looks like the part that says Two Brothers doesn't... It looks a lot more like tin or wood, and I was just curious.
It looks great.
It looks great, but what I'm saying is it doesn't meet our exterior.
Well, we're working. Helen Keaton is our construction manager for this. I'll cover this with her and make sure it meets all your requirements.
Or you come back to us for a PUD.
Yes, sir.
Revision. Thanks.
We'll do. I will cover that with Helen.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Pond Hill Retail, you've obviously seen it's going up there on the corner. I don't have elevations attached to this. Cecilia's been busy leasing up that area, approximately 6,000 square feet. We have local coffee signed on the end cap. We have a sign permitted for 1604 that's being installed in approximately 2 weeks. And local coffee is going to finish out if they haven't already started. So things are moving quickly there. Obviously, the rain put us back a little bit here lately, but everything's coming together, and Cecilia's working with, you know, just different operators, you know, some more retail, some food folks, and trying to put those deals together.
And maybe nobody else finds this interesting, but the construction of the building, if you've been watching it, so it's got the metal framing, and then they're putting a shell around it, but it's not built on a slab, which is kind of unique.
Cecilia can tell you how
yeah,
it's built.
Come on up, Cecilia.
It's really cool.
And the front of the building does does not face Northwest Military.
Right, right.
So that's going to be a little bit different because we've got that beautiful pond mm-hmm. where mm-hmm. the tennis courts are, and so it really lends itself to a really beautiful overlook, especially for people like Local Coffee that are going to have an outdoor seating area. They can take advantage of that. But the reason for not doing the slab was really a cost efficient for both the developer and the tenants, because if we put the slab in, these are smaller users from 1,215 square feet up to 1,800 square feet. So these are, you know, mom and pop, local, for the most part. And so not putting that slab in initially will save the developer money, but it saves them money too, because normally what they have to do to put their plumbing in is they break that concrete up mm-hmm. and then they have to re-pour it. So yeah, the structure supports itself along the perimeter of the building. So it's a little bit different.
It's interesting.
But we're innovators, so.
Yes. That's cool.
Moving on to the other side of Northwest Military at the southeast corner, obviously we have Starbucks just doing a great business there, McAllister's doing a great business. We have been really focused on engineering for the last year and a half on the site with the grades. You know, we filled the frontage there on 1604. On lot four that you see, we do have lot four under contract with Zaxby's. They're new to the market. They're a great user. You know, it's chicken, salads. I mm-hmm. mean, go to the website. I mean, it's a good use there. And so we are under contract with them. And we're planning out, you know, the rest of the pads. We're talking to several other users, not far enough for me to divulge, but we're making progress.
Okay. So, no, go ahead, Michelle.
Oh, I was going to say, so we're taking care of how we direct traffic. How are they going to get on from 1604? They're going to have to come down Northwest Military, or they'll be able to have a cut-in above
Starbucks?
Let me see
if I don't have the detailed engineering drawings, but I'm going to paraphrase for you. Between lot three and lot four, what you don't see is a drive coming down between lot three and four, and that continues through lot seven to tie into Collins.
Okay.
You're also going to have the continuation of the drive off of Northwest Military that currently ends right at the Starbucks PL property line there. So that's going to be coming in.
Okay.
So you're going to have
a couple
plenty
options.
Of great circulation you know, coming through there. And then eventually we'll be tying in lot five to Collins Circle. So there is an enormous amount of infrastructure dollars that will be put into this area for both drives, sanitary sewer, water, and WPAP outfall.
So, I just know how congested it gets at Northwest Military, and I spent a lot of time in the drive-thru at Starbucks. They really need a second turn, a second window. and I just know that once we add other stuff, you know, we need to have other ins and outs.
No, we're absolutely cognizant of that. And that's why it's just we're really trying to make another sale because the cost of infrastructure is so expensive there. But we need it. You can't cheap Charlie this and expect to have something where folks are going to go and, you know, they just get frustrated if they don't have the circulation patterns that they need.
Daryl, have you already platted lots 3, 4, and 5?
We have not.
So if Michelle could sell Starbucks part of lot three to where y'all could actually get some real lease money out of them, that would be acceptable.
We could. Unfortunately, there's probably about a 6 or 7 foot cut wall there.
Yeah, there is.
And I don't know if you ramp up or they have an elevator.
Yeah,
but
chop saw.
That's right.
But the area is definitely getting on the radar screen with Baptist going in across the way and more office. Folks need places to go for lunch, you know, beyond just what's on the north side of 1604. And while go to the next slide. Bear with me. Let's go to the very next slide, Curtis. Right here, unit 19A, we're starting to pre-plan this area. This is plus or minus 20 acres. Again, we have topo issues. We have drainage issues that we need to overcome. That square there is the former Frost site. Frost still owns it. We are very close to having a contract with a user for that. They need a little bit of additional land, which we would grant them if we can come to terms. But that's a retail slash office use. Looks really nice. We're just not there yet with a signed deal. So, and then obviously we need to come back and replat the Frost site. Now the WPAP is all done there. So that's all done with TCEQ. simply come in and replat and add a small section. So that's on the radar. This is a little bit fuzzy. I'm sorry the PDF didn't come out great, and we'll update this with new exhibits next time. The Huntington Center Phase 1, that's what Cecilia's been successful with, Lone Star, WellAware, some other big name users on the way, and just a really good looking building there. You also have Huntington Center Phase 2, so that's just east of this, almost can do a sister building. And so it's good to have that land. Say if someone comes and says, hey, Cecilia, I need 35,000 square feet, we can roll them right into a new building, you know, there. KFW is completed, great looking building there with KFW. Bader House, Phase 1 is done. Phase 2, they have an option on, they're in the option period. And we just have to see if they're going to close it or not. If not, we'll bring that piece of land back, okay? There's a great picture of a Huntington commercial. This is a better rendering. This is from the PUD exhibit, which shows you a little better the actual plan outline for that area. Let's skip over to Napier Park. You're gonna be reviewing the final plats for two sections of Napier Park. This is anchored by the Meridian Assisted Living, 4 acres there right in front of Blattman. And we sold that tract to Meridian to give us the infrastructure dollars that we needed to extend this collector road for Napier. And if you're not familiar, Napier Park Village, Office Village, is, you know, high-end Class A office where we'll deliver a shell. So say you're a doctor, an attorney, psychologist, we're going to deliver a shell in the land for one set price. You'll come in, do your finish out, and we'll have cohesive architectural control throughout, plus a COA for continuing maintenance ongoing. So we're finalizing budgets for that. The collector road is in, the WPAP is in. So we know once we start going on it, here's a rendering. Napier Park, this is a building 5, approximately 4,200 square feet. This building is efficient to build. It's a good looking building, metal roof, and it allows us to customize in certain ways so it's not a cookie cutter approach to everything.
And they're all one story?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And so what you've done is you've platted the road.
Yes.
And other than the road, the rest of it would be platted out of this PUD, building by building, basically. And as we do that, will we be modifying your PUD agreement to address parking, or how did we decide finally to do that?
I believe we have notes on the plat for the PUD. Yes.
Okay.
And we're gonna keep moving east. This is Inwood Commercial. Now, this is outside of Shavano Park, but I wanna just bring it to your attention. We have approximately 6.6 acres left. We have a contract pending on 4.6 acres closest to the strip center there at the corner. We had a 2-acre deal go away today there. That's why you just can never represent if something's going to close or not, you know, for one reason or another. But it's a great area, and we expect that office to be continuing to build out there. And there might be a restaurant pad there. This shows exactly that 2-acre site there next to Dr. Iskander and the Prestige ER, and then the remaining 4.6 acres. And we have cross access out to bidders with great circulation on that site. On the north side, again, this is City of San Antonio. You have a ridgeline at Rogers Ranch. That's the Embry project. I mean, it just looks great out there. Casitas, some townhomes, traditional, you know, apartment units, just a real nice blend. Going to be some of the highest rents per square foot in the city, probably approaching $2 by the time it's all said and done, $2 a square foot. Modeled after one of their Denver plans, and so they adapted it here for San Antonio. So Happy's Round, is that the? Happy's Round is the traffic circle there. We have that cut in and developed, and we're starting to market office and retail for this area. Okay. And then just wrapping up and bringing it home, this is, you can put a little bit higher there. This is the northwest corner of Northwest Military and 1604. So directly across from the existing Chase. And this is the Baptist Emergency Center. And this has, you know, room for, you know, emergency critical care. and then it has additional office space for lease for doctors. And a good-looking building there, approximately 3 acres, and then we'll start planning retail and future office west of there.
Okay. Daryl, on Napier Park, what is y'all's rollout time frame? You know, you've got two buildings that you think are coming on board. How long and how many buildings do you think you'll build? How many years do you think it'll take to complete, and how many buildings per year, assuming that the economy doesn't do a 2008 on us?
Yeah, we're thinking anywhere from 3 to 5 years. The project is not marked to a certain velocity. The project is marked to the highest end possible at the market. And if that means we have a longer time, then we have a longer time. But you know, we want to get two buildings out of the ground, you know, 1 to 2 buildings here in the next 8 to 10 months. We think once those buildings come out of the ground, our velocity will naturally progress.
Yeah.
But we do not, we are not in a cost-cutting mode there. We're in a premium product mode, and we think folks will see that, you know, as the development moves.
Okay. Have y'all considered moving y'all's office out of Oakwell Farms out to Napier Park?
I am not authorized.
Okay.
Mr. Denton may talk about that.
Well, he didn't turn red, so it wasn't too embarrassing. Yeah. I'm looking at this, and it looks like there are about 13 buildings. Is this what your build-out, is this what y'all are envisioning as far as this build-out would be?
At this point, now, that doesn't mean if someone comes to us with, you know, a certain 12,000 square foot requirement that might be single story, you know, we could combine a couple lots. You know, we have that flexibility and obviously come to you for approval through the platting process and the PUD. But right now, you know, we're looking in that 4,200 to 5,800 square foot range for this first, as I call it, pod, you know, of buildings. So that's where we're seeing the sweet spot. And that might be someone, that might be a psychologist that needs, let's say it's 5,200 square feet. Psychologist maybe needs 4,000 square feet. And then they have another 1,200 square feet that they can lease to a single attorney or two attorneys, maybe a shared kitchen space. And that way they have room to grow, you know, in 5 or 6 years.
Okay.
So it's flexible.
Is there any possibility of restaurants on the backside approaching the linear park? Is that one of your items that you would consider, or is this entirely office?
We were thinking that maybe that building C there that has some frontage up on the frontage might be a quasi retail type, you know, building. We haven't had much traction with retail or restaurant back here. I think the users would be afraid to be the first ones there. Just my take. Doesn't mean that you couldn't have a cool something, you know, back there. It's just we haven't been targeting, you know, that use. Because it is a destination. It's not something like a Starbucks right there on the corner. Mm-hmm. Get in, get out. And that would be the challenge.
So in the next 12 months, Daryl, do y'all have an estimate, a range of what y'all are projecting as far as your square footage build out in this 12-month period of time?
Yeah, probably, you know, average, one 5,400 square foot building, another building about 42, so right around 10,000 square feet, you know, for the Bitterblue side of things. And again, we think once we have a spec building up, people will get it. You know, we're the show me state when it comes to development. And folks don't want to see a sign, they want to see it built. And we think once they see that, you've got the congestion of Stone Oak, you know, we'll bring them over to our side and, you know, be able to justify our higher rates, because they're going to be higher rates. Just no doubt about it.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
But anybody? They're going to be, Michelle? In Shavano Park, and they'll be paying less property tax.
Yes, ma'am.
Absolutely. Mike?
At the last meeting, I voted against the Napier plat because no one could answer my question about, or would answer my question about tree preservation. I sat through the P&Z presentation, and y'all are saying that that's going to, tree preservation is important to you. That's one of the consistent complaints that I've heard from the residents, is the clear cutting that's taken place And so what are y'all doing about trying to save some trees instead of going through cutting down almost heritage oaks and putting twigs back up in their place?
Well, excuse me, I'm Laddie Denton.
Thank you, Laddie.
This particular site, we had a tree survey on the entire site, and we located the road and all of the utilities in such a way as we could minimize the destruction with the tree coverage, because that's essentially what we're selling, is a kind of that kind of environment along the creek with the greenway coming in and so forth. We have topographic issues that we'll have to deal with, where we're going to have to take some trees out in order to build on the site itself, and this primarily is the area adjacent to Blattman. In that particular area, we'll come back with landscaping. The only place in Shavano Park we have ever done major clearing was on 1604 in conjunction with the padding out of the frontage on 1604 on Collins Circle in Northwest Military. And when we did that, we also did a tree survey, and then we came in and talked to the city, and we went to the Planning and Zoning Commission and to the City Council, and we explained very carefully what we were doing and why we were doing it, and sought their permission in order to do so. We sell trees, we sell the environment, we sell Shavano Park. That's what we're doing, that's what we're here for. We're pushing the envelope as far as we can on the values that we try to create by what we develop. So if there's the impression that we're clear cutting or anything like that, that's certainly not the intent. And where we get into some serious type of situations where we need to remove a bunch of trees, we will come in and discuss it with the city before it happens. And if we usually are always intend to get permission or the approval of the city before we do so. There are circumstances with utilities and with topography, as I said, where we have to deal with it, and it does mount, require the removal of some of the vegetation.
Okay, Mike. And of course, the Paramount property was significantly cleared. Of course, that's where the footprint of the building is going to be. And so the trees come out. But there weren't very many oak trees that were left there. Was that because there were just a whole lot of mesquite and cedars in that particular location? Because sometimes in the hill country, we really don't have heritage trees. We've got a lot of cedar.
A lot of the frontage on 1604 was very unusual vegetation, and also the geology of it. We had a lot of clay. It wasn't the typical rock that we have throughout most of Shavano Park. And the vegetation was very mixed with cedar, hackberry, just about everything along in there. And then we have seams like where Two Brothers. That's got a whole lot of heritage oak in there that we work very carefully to get around. If we have that kind of circumstance and we try to get around it, the cedar, we prefer to get rid of it for the most part, unless it's providing some type of screen.
Okay, and of course on the cedar are not protected trees in Shavano Park. They're completely excluded from our tree preservation ordinance. Same thing with agarita and mesquite and plants of that type.
Yes.
Okay. Does anybody else have any questions concerning the commercial development before we go to the residential development? Alan.
Yes, my question is, has there been any more thought to putting another cut through the median on Lock Hill, Selma? Because of the overload on Bentley Manor across from 54, 53, whatever that number is. Because at this point in time, the no U-turn signs are not really working. I come in and out of that intersection all the time.
This is not the best map because it doesn't really have the detail. We looked at this with Pape Dawson Engineering. There's a significant grade differential where we looked at having a potential median cut to the point of $150,000 to $250,000 for a simple median cut. The commercial area there, the plus or minus 4 acres, they have shared access with Paramount, as does that small office building to the north. And they have a full four-way, median there. And that was the reason, during platting that was a condition. So we're hoping when those all fully develops out, that some of that traffic will come towards the Paramount and leave, that way. The cost-benefit ratio of the, $250,000 for that median, relocating utilities, it was just something we weren't prepared to move forward with right now.
Okay, that's a good question, Alan.
That's it.
Okay. Then we'll talk about residential development.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Daryl.
Okay, we are coming to the end on residential.
Don't do it.
Finally. I've included a city map in the package just for reference on the various areas. I don't think that made it into your... this is a summary of what we have left in Shavano Park. Bentley Manor Villas, Willowwood, Huntington, Pond Hill Garden Villas, the total lots in each area, the lots that we have either closed, and the lots that we have left to develop. Obviously, Huntington being the big one. Of those, Bentley Manor on the north end, that last unit is under development right now, should be completed in September. That is the Garden Villas. And that's the end of that particular product, and that we will be complete on that side of Shavano Park with residential.
And you've sold all those lots, and you've sold them to Meridian and Davis, or what?
In Bentley Manor?
Yes.
No, it's Monticello and it's
Monticello,
Prestige.
I'm sorry.
The two builders that are in there currently will finish it out.
Okay.
And that's Monticello and who?
Prestige.
That's right.
That made me nervous.
In Willowwood, we are sold out of the lots. Davis is the builder in there, and we have six. He has six left to complete. That's in your... No, that's Huntington.
No.
That's right. Not there.
Not there.
That's Huntington. I'll just skip. Willowood, for our intents and purposes, is finished. He's probably going to take another year to finish those six or seven houses he has left to build. Most of them are all contracts. The price range in that particular area has gotten up in the 700 to a million range, which surpassed what we ever anticipated. Going back to Bentley for a moment, that price range has also gotten up there again. It's back to the pre-recession year levels of about in the 5 to 650 range, and most of that's coming in as custom. This is Huntington. Huntington's our crown jewel on the residential side. It's done very well. Most of that product is now in the 1.5 to 2 million, and just about everything that we've seen come in through the office for approval is well over 2 million. We're not in any hurry here, and we're just finishing. We have finished the last unit, and we will be probably starting another unit next year. The demand currently is really surprised us that there's that much demand in this particular price range, but Huntington apparently has hit its identity. Mm-hmm. And we will finish it out with probably the group of builders that are in there currently. And the last residential area, Pond Hill Villas, we just paved it. We're finishing it up now with the walls and the security gates and so forth. And we recorded the plat hopefully tomorrow, and the building permits are in for the first three units, which he should start. Again, this will be Steve Davis. He should start those units probably within 2 to 3 weeks.
So did you put in a community pool there?
No.
Retention pond?
No, we made it real simple.
There's blue water, it looks like.
That goes with that house.
Oh, cool.
Very, very nice lot. There's a second phase of...
Did you decide on your pricing yet in Pond Hill?
We can start down in the low 40s, probably 440 in that. Well, that's not really low 40s, more like mid 400s. And the discussions that he's had on the units so far, most of it looks over 500, so it's probably going to be in the 500 to 600 range. And this is primarily a function of move-down buyers who really want to finish out the interiors, and they're spending the money on the interiors. And so it should be really nice. And there is a second phase on the east side that we shelved in favor of the west side because of the topography was really, really difficult. If this goes well and we can move the price points, then we can go to the east side. Probably, we think this is probably 3 years. Huntington, we probably have 6 years, 5 to 6 years.
I will say Huntington is, I drive through the neighborhoods all the time. Willowwood looks really good, but Huntington looks just great. I mean, it's an awesome neighborhood. It really is.
Thank you. We're trying to encourage more diverse architecture.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you got some contemporary homes in there now. I'm excited.
Yeah, it's a trend. Any questions?
Okay. Laddie, y'all... on Pond Hill, you were using a limited number of footprints. Is that still the case, or is that changing as the price point is changing?
We're going to try to stay with the. We have seven different floor plans, really two stories, and the rest are all one stories. We anticipate most of it's going to be one story, and we're trying to stay with those footprints because they're all designed for the lot sizes. And the, as you know, there's five different lot sizes, so that's what we're going to try to stay with, and we can change the interiors. But the project that we model this after down in Alamo Heights, I mean, we can do custom, and we will do custom if we need to.
Okay. So, anybody else?
The building that's sure. Beyond, well, you don't know because it's Partners in Wealth, but will that be probably multiple stories?
The plans we have seen are one story.
I was just thinking bigger buffer from 1604.
We restricted and we notated the buffer. They have to abide by the buffer. That's all.
No, I mean as in taller building to block off the sounds from the 1604.
The way it situates the site plan that they did give us, it works very well on that site. The way it's situated and you know, we've protected the buffers, and again, they cannot build anything until we approve their elevation.
Have you seen the north wall of Pond Hill?
Yeah.
Okay, anybody else have any questions, any comments? Laddie, thank you, and Daryl very much. Excellent presentation. Okay, item 6.6, discussion of action adopting a policy to allow citizens to address the city council during council meetings, apart from citizens to be heard. Alderman Simpson. Mike?
I would move that we immediately adopt a policy that the City Council allows respectful input from citizens concerning agenda items properly before the Council during debate, and direct that the City Manager draft an implementing policy memorandum for approval of the Council at the next special or regular Council meeting. If I receive a second, I'll speak to that motion.
Okay. We have a motion. Do we have a second?
I second.
And there's a second by Mary Ann. Mike?
We previously had this policy or practice under Mayor Marn where citizens could address the council during the council meeting. And my belief is that the citizens of Shavano Park are pretty bright. They're successful. They know what they're doing, and that the vast majority of the smarts of Shavano Park exist on the other side of this dais. And the ability of the citizens to offer suggestions or ask questions of their representatives during the meeting, I think, is just critical to the efficient running of a democracy. So I think this is just a sound policy that the council ought to adopt, and the mayor would have the ability to control the time and certainly to control any input that got out of hand, the usual decorum being expected, and I wouldn't expect anything else from our citizens.
Okay. Do we have any other discussion? Okay. We have a motion and a second. Mike, by immediate, or just as a point of clarification, are you talking about it would be effective immediately today? Are you talking it would be effective upon presentation of a policy that is approved by City Council? Because you talked about both of those things, and I would appreciate some clarification.
Yes, sir. The intent is that we muddle through the rest of the meeting, allowing citizens who want to address us to go ahead and do it. And then the city manager, there were some suggested parameters in the agenda item. City manager comes back with a formal policy memorandum for our approval at the next meeting.
Okay. So it is the motion, if you could restate it, the motion is for the city manager and staff to come up with a policy to allow citizens to direct questions and to interact.
Here's the motion. I move we immediately adopt a policy that the City Council allows respectful input from citizens concerning agenda items properly before the council during debate and direct the city manager to draft an implementing policy memorandum for approval of the council at the next special or regular council meeting.
Okay. The word immediately is the one that I'm having trouble with, Mike, because immediately is now.
Roger.
So that would mean that citizens would interact with us the rest of this meeting without a policy. Is that what you're saying? I'm just asking.
Trusting your ability to control debate, yes, Mr.
Mayor. Okay, very good. We have a motion and a second. Do we have any further discussion?
Yeah, I'll make some comments. So,
Bob?
When I first was elected to city council, and Mayor Martin was the mayor at the time, one of the things that was quite obvious to me was the meetings, in my opinion, got out of hand somewhat. I know on several occasions we left it here after 11 o'clock at night, and a lot of that was because of the discussions that went on throughout the meetings. I am an advocate of citizens always having access to us as representatives, and we have provided many forums for that to be the case. And I encourage that always. I think citizens to be heard is one of my favorite things now, because we really do hear exactly what citizens think. We have access all the time, email, phone calls. We have open access meetings in every meeting that we do, whether it's workshops, et cetera. So I fear that this is not something that would be conducive to efficiency. As you commented, Mike, I don't think efficiency would be very productive. And I think our job as city council members is to work off the agenda that's been given to us by both the staff and the council members that provide agenda items per constituents in the city of Shavano Park. And I think that's what we need to stick with. But I am absolutely in support of citizens having access and being able to have dialogue. I just don't think this is the forum to do it in what's being proposed.
Okay. Do we have any further discussion? Okay. If there's no further discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, same sign.
Aye.
The motion fails. Item 6.7. Discussion action, encourage solar by considering lowering permitting costs for solar electricity panels on residential and commercial properties. Michelle.
Oh, I'll let you defer. I can't speak well.
Okay. I've got a motion there. I move we direct the city manager to determine the cost to the city to review proposed plans for installation of solar generation and the cost of inspections required by the international codes, and recommend to the council a permitting fee sufficient to cover the cost to the city for its management of permits and inspections only.
Okay, so your motion is to send back to our staff a recommendation for a minimalist cost to cover, basically. To basically pass through the cost. And so I'm assuming that that means at the lower of the permitting fee currently provided or cost. So it would not be, because there could be situations where the cost of solar could be more expensive than the cost of our permitting fees. That is a possibility. So I'm assuming you're asking for the lower of.
I'm asking for the city to charge no more than what it costs it to review the plans and conduct the inspections.
Okay.
I second that.
And Michelle has seconded the motion. Okay, we're now open for discussion.
The reason that I brought this is a citizen brought it to me, my attention that he tried to install, well, he is going to install solar panels. He got charged the standard permitting fee. And I think we need to, we as the city leadership should encourage conservation and that solar generation. So we shouldn't penalize that, and it shouldn't be a profit center for the city. It should just be what it costs us to do our job and nothing more.
Okay. In that process, Mike, are you suggesting then, because this is citizen driven, that we have an effective date of July 1 for all projects on or after July 1?
Well, there's until the city manager brings back a recommendation, I don't know what how we can adopt it.
I just wanted to lift that up, that it sounded like that was
targeted. So it's just tell him to do this, come back to us, and then I guess we get to talk about it again.
Do we have any further discussion?
And I just wanted to say the same citizen contacted me, which is why we have this agenda item together.
And he contacted me and Bill as well. Mary may have contacted everybody. Does anybody have any discussion? If there is no further discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. The motion carries. Item 6.8, discussion proposed fiscal year 2016-2017 budget. Bill.
Okay, so we've been working the budget a long time. I'll just kind of summarize this. City manager proposed budget was presented to council on the 4th of August. On the 11th of August, city council took a record vote of proposed tax rate of 0.294780, which equaled the effective tax rate. Of course, council's not required to adopt that tax rate. The city manager's budget was lower than that. We've had several workshops associated with the city manager with the proposed budget. There's been some feedback and questions associated with that. We have itemized in here those portions of the budget that we have made slight adjustments to. There hasn't been a lot of major muscle moves associated with the budget. This agenda item is really another opportunity for the council to provide any specific guidance, only in because the first public hearing of the council's approved budget will be the 12th of September and the 19th of September is the second reading. You'll recall we've moved the September regularly scheduled council meeting to the 19th, where we will adopt the budget after the second public hearing. Again, you can see there's only been a few items that have been adjusted. If you want me to read them, I can. But the big key is that the compensation study was presented as approved in the Werling study, was presented initially, and it still remains fully funded into this budget. Subject to your questions and guidance, we will then prepare the final budget for council approval on 12 September.
Okay. Bill, just a point of clarification before I open this up for a motion for discussion. Did council vote for the effective tax rate, or did they vote to have a rate equal to or less than the effective tax rate?
They did not vote for the effective tax rate.
They voted to set
the tax rate to be equal to or less.
Yeah, so they did not vote for any rate, in fact. They voted
What is the rate that gets published?
The rate that gets published is what the record vote was that council took.
And what is the rate that will be published as a result of that record vote?
It has already been published, and that rate was the effective tax rate, which was, as I mentioned before, 0.294780.
And it doesn't say in that publication or lower, or does it?
I don't know. I have printed it off somewhere, but I don't have it handy. It probably says, I don't know. I don't want to even speculate. Do you know?
I don't think it says or lower.
Okay.
Because there's a statute that requires us to state the rate.
Well, obviously we didn't take that vote correctly.
Well, we took the vote correctly.
Yeah, we did.
Okay, very good. Okay.
The effect of the vote was to publish the effective rate.
Yes, because it didn't require us to have public hearings because it's under the rollback rate.
Yeah, and okay. We don't come up with the verbiage associated with that. We provide the rate that council voted for, and it's published in a standard form.
By statute, right?
Well, by the taxing district.
Okay, do we have a motion to open discussion?
So moved.
Second.
Bob and Michelle. Michelle made the motion and Bob made the second. So we're open for discussion. Do we have any discussion?
Yes, sir.
Mike.
I would move that under 70, fund number 70.
This is a discussion item. It's not an action item.
Okay, then I would like to see under fund number 70 that we take the undesignated 39,000 and change and the municipal track 26,000 and change and move those monies into the fire capital line item rather than leaving undesignated there and municipal track there.
Okay. Is there a discussion? Is there further discussion? Okay. If there's no further discussion, then we will proceed to item 6.9. Discussion action briefing by the city manager on procedures to nominate and appoint citizens to boards, committees, and commissions. Discussion and possible action concerning those procedures. Bill?
Okay, so this was a request from Alderman Simpson so we could review this process. And in your packet, I've outlined that for history purposes, council adopted a policy that appoints the members to boards, committees, and commissions. There's been a number of tweaks associated with it over the years. I'll just to kind of review the current ordinance, as it says, solicitations for applications shall be made to all residents to serve on the standing committees. The application document is issued by the city council, city secretary, and we provide that on the website. She also provides the current vacancies for the standing commissions, committees, and boards. We've published that in the Roadrunner. It's on our website now, advertising that applications must be submitted to the city secretary by September 1st each year, and the applications stay on file each year. There are provisions for multiple vacancies on a commission, committee, or board, and so when multiple vacancies occur, they're filled in the following subsection. The city secretary shall assemble and distribute the committee applications packets to city council by the second Monday of September. And for each board, the alderman will consider each application. And then each alderman will nominate the same number of applicants as the vacancies for each committee. So for example, if there's three vacancies on the water committee, each alderman will nominate three members for the Water Advisory Committee. And at the next regularly scheduled City Council meeting, the City Secretary shall present the information as provided by the City Council members. So, again, the City Secretary provides your package. It's got all the applications. It's got the number of vacancies. You provide back to the City Council, to the City Secretary, your selection or your nomination for each one of these. So there'll be six different applications, different feedbacks back to the city secretary. The city council will then consider the information and shall appoint to each vacancy a qualified applicant to serve on the appropriate board or a committee. So that's what we expect in this piece. There is a paragraph talking about single vacancies. And do we have, is the investment committee open for a single? We have one is available on the investment committee for a single vacancy. So when that occurs, again, the council shall fill the vacancy following notice to the city manager from three or four council members that they wish to fill a vacancy. For example, a couple of months ago, one of the members of the Water Advisory Committee resigned. Had three or more of the council members said, we want to fill the vacancy, then that would have initiated that process. Or the chairman of the commission, committee, or board may request to the city manager to bring that board vacancy before the council. In this case, with the Water Advisory Committee, neither of that occurred. I mean, I reached out to the chairman of the Water Advisory Committee. He did not wish to fill that. We did not get requests from three council members. And that's really meant for if someone resigns, because I don't. So if we had the Water Advisory Committee, the city secretary shall assemble and distribute committee application packets to all city council. At the same time, staff provides the council packets to the council members. Only applications on dates on file at such date shall be considered by the council. At the request of any council member, the city secretary shall make a special solicitation for the position, and that's kind of off cycle. Let's say that an investment committee member drops out, no applications are on hand, we wouldn't be able to present that. A council member could say, I want to solicit another run for that, in which we would solicit further applications based upon a deadline, and then we will present it. And then following a meeting, affirmative majority vote following a nomination is second by council members, the single applicant would be approved. The only other thing to say is that when the city secretary puts the packet together, she'll include the ordinances, so you can see the references associated with that. There'll be attendance of the current board members or commissioners, so that you can see they've been on board for 2 years. Here's what their attendance record is. There'll be a matrix of all applicants listing the board preference. So some folks will put the planning and zoning first, some will put the Water Advisory Committee first. And so they may have four committees they have applied to, first, second, third, fourth choice, and there'll be a copy of applications. Other than that, it'll be a hard copy for each one of you, subject to your questions, to either me or Zena. She runs the show.
Okay. We're going to open up with a motion for discussion. Do we have a motion to discuss?
So moved.
Alderman Barrier, thank you, Alan. Motion discussed. We have a second on the motion to discuss. Bob is second in the motion. Okay, we're open for discussion on our policies and procedures. On just generally. Mike, you wanted us to talk about this.
All I wanted him was for him to brief. I'm not advocating changing at this point.
Alan?
Yes, I just wanted to ask the basic question, what do the highlights mean in yellow, if anything? Are they changes?
So normal practice, Alderman Barrier, is that any updates from the previous month, I highlight it in yellow, and then you can skim and see the changes. In this case, we hadn't presented it, but we wanted to make sure that the dates 1 September were tracking, and that Zena would provide this by the second Monday of September. I highlighted that, and that you only can nominate the same number of applicants as vacancies for that committee. I just wanted to, for emphasis, that's why it was highlighted.
Okay. Do we have any further discussion? Okay, if there's no further discussion, then we're going to go on to item 610. Discussion action recording the council workshop meetings for the benefit of residents in accordance with the city's record control maintenance policy and council's goals and objectives for promoting open, clear, proactive, and transparent communications and outreach with citizens. Mary Ann.
Mayor, I would move to include council workshops as meetings to be recorded for viewing and publication on the city's YouTube channel and website in accordance with the city's records control management policy and to comport with council's stated values, goals, and objectives about promoting open, clear, proactive, and transparent communications and outreach with citizens.
Okay. We have a motion to include workshops in our YouTube channel. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a second by Alderman Simpson. We're now open for discussion. Michelle?
I would like to point out that I wasn't at the meeting that was referenced in this packet, but there were three attorneys there, and no one stopped the meeting and said that it should have been taped or that we should have been following the rules. So I don't know how now that's an issue because everybody was there but me, and nobody did anything about it, and now it's an agenda item.
Okay.
I have simple reasons that are set out in the packet. I won't really belabor those. One, the workshops, like special and regular meetings, are governed by the Texas Open Meetings Act because they're meetings at which a quorum of us are present and dealing with city business. That's not my opinion, it's fact. Number two, video recording and posting our workshops as we do our regular and special meetings costs us nothing. We already have the technology in place, and our digital storage capabilities will not be impacted. Number three, it does two things. One, it better tracks the spirit and intent of the Texas Open Meetings Act. Two, it allows us as a council to do with concrete action what we talk about doing every time we meet. It's one of our stated goals and objectives as a council to, quote, promote open, clear, proactive, and transparent communication and outreach with citizens, end quote. Video recording and posting workshops is just one more way we objectively meet that goal. And finally, doing so tracks what numerous Texas cities are currently doing. In the 3 months since May 2016, we've had 7 workshops. In fact, we've had more workshops during that time frame than we've had special or regular meetings combined. What we do during these workshops is important, and it impacts residents. We wouldn't be having them otherwise. It's absolutely true that residents are always welcome to attend all our meetings, including workshops in person. The reality is, though, that not everyone can, and that's the beauty of our video recording and posting capabilities. The numbers show that more residents are digesting the meetings we record and post on the city's website and YouTube channel than ever attend in person. Finally, I know my colleagues agree that we're discussing important information during these workshops because we're holding town halls to provide residents another bite at that information apple. If workshops and what we discuss in them are important enough to be the subject of town halls, they're important enough to be available for review by residents who find themselves unable to attend such meetings in person.
Okay.
Ultimately, video recording and posting workshops in the same way we do our regular and special meetings is win-win for everyone. It's one more way we provide residents an opportunity to get involved and stay informed. And it allows us to let our actions speak louder than our words. For these reasons, I ask my colleagues to get behind this stated commitment that we have to open, clear, proactive, and transparent communication with tangible action. And we can do that tonight by agreeing together to allow us to record council workshops in the same way we do for special and regular meetings.
Okay, that didn't address my statement at all. First of all, it's legal to tape. You must tape every meeting. You do not have to videotape every meeting.
You sure don't.
You don't. And second of all, my comment was that the example given was that we should not, you guys, should not have approved something in a special meeting, which I agree with you on that point.
I never said that.
No, that's what's in the packet. It talks to that agenda. It talks to the minutes, and the minutes say that they voted, that Alderman Simpson made a motion to repair the roof of the fire station, and that should not have been made because it was in a special
I never said
workshop
that.
Meeting. Yes, all it does.
It says, in essence, the meeting was a hybrid meeting, part workshop and part special. So okay. We didn't record the workshop.
Let's just make sure that one of you has finished talking before the other one starts, okay?
I just want to be clear, that's what's in the packet is I didn't.
What's in the packet, I'm agreeing with you, so I don't know why you're arguing with me.
I'm not arguing with you, Michelle.
The point is that the special meeting should have been videotaped. The workshop did not have to be. And because it was a workshop, there should not have been any vote by council to repair the roof of the fire station because it was not conducted during the special meeting.
Well, actually, Michelle,
we don't make decisions in the special.
There was a special meeting. And what happened was that the workshop section of it was not delineated in a separate agenda.
Yes.
And so we went from the special meeting, which was a special meeting, and the recording was not turned on at the beginning of that. It is an administrative error.
Yes.
Administrative errors happen. And so let's not get into arguments about
administrative. And be clear, Mayor, I'm not arguing. Easy thing to do would just be to record all the meetings.
Okay. Now, a question, one of the things that you said was people are really watching these videos. Curtis, are people really watching these videos? I know that we now have the ability to track that with our new system. Have we actually looked to see whether people are interested in, and you know, do Alan and I need to go and spoof up a little bit because we're the old, well, Mike is old too, but the three of us on the middle of the cordage that we look old.
I can tell you that. The fact is that we have had, we have 15 videos posted. We've got about 30 subscribers. We've got about 1,000 views for an average of about 63 views per video.
Okay.
But each video, every time I log on, I get another credit. So if I go log on five times to look at the same thing, I get five hits. So it's not like.
Is that true?
Yes.
Okay. I think that everybody might be interested in that, Curtis. It makes our facts specific. Okay. Do we have any further discussion?
The only other thing that I would add is that it does track what other or communities are doing. Floresville, Helotes, Bastrop, Prairie View, Lamar, College Station, just as an example. What I did was just do a quick YouTube search, brought up in excess of 140,000 hits for Texas cities that record and post workshops. And again, I'm not trying to argue with anybody. I'm just trying to say it's a simple thing. It's let's let our actions speak louder than this stated goal of open and transparent communication. It's one other additional tool and benefit that we provide to residents. It's not for us. It's for residents.
Okay. Do we have any further discussion? There's no further. Mike.
I just think that giving the residents a chance to listen to us as we talk about why we're doing what we're doing, and that's what workshops are about, exchange of ideas and developing positions and courses of action, that is just an outstanding opportunity for the citizens to hear what we're thinking, why we're thinking, and get an idea of why we're doing what we're doing. And so there's no better way than just watching that. If you can't be here in person, then watching that on a recording. And I just don't see a downside to it.
Okay. Do we have any further discussion? There being no further discussion, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed, same sign.
Aye.
The motion carries. Item 6.1. Michelle, are we going to proceed with this, or are you going to make a motion to postpone until the next meeting?
I'm going to make a motion to postpone to the next meeting because the gentleman is out of town.
Okay. I have a motion to postpone, which is like a motion to table until the September regular council meeting. Is that correct?
Yes.
Do I have a second?
I'll
second. Bob is second in the motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, same sign. The motion carries. Item 6.611 is to be on the next agenda bill without a submission because it has been postponed to the next meeting. Item 6.12, discussion action resolution R-2016-016, adopting a policy requiring all committees and subcommittees of the City Council, Planning and Zoning Commission, Water Board, and any other municipal board, corporation, or commission to post notice of meetings and to conduct its meetings in a location open to the general public. Mike?
This is just formalizing what we've already done, so I would move approval of Resolution R-2016-016, adopting the policy as stated.
Okay. Mike has made a motion to adopt Resolution R-2016-016 as provided. Do we have a second?
I second.
Mary Ann has seconded the motion. We're now open for discussion. Is there any discussion? Okay, if there's no discussion, all in favor say aye.
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 All opposed, same sign.
Aye. Aye.
And the motion fails. Item 613, discussion action review of the tree trimming permit fees and permit period. Michelle?
Well, the reason it's on here and is because of a couple of things. One, I've had a couple of residents contact me because they don't like the fact that we've made the period a 10-day period and they want it to be longer. And two, we need to review the form that we use. And for some reason, it seems that staff has extended the ordinance, not followed the ordinance, because I got a tree trimming permit that said it was good till the end of September, which was more than 10 days. So if we're not following the ordinance, we need to discuss changing it. And we need to fix the permit form, because the permit form talks about, it's supposed to be oak wilt, and it says that you need to get a permit to trim any trees, and that's not what the ordinance says. So I just would like staff to work on that and hopefully bring something back to us. And I don't know how anybody else feels about the tree trimming permit schedule. We can lengthen it to the time in the summer and the time in the winter. We could do it for a whole year. The whole reason we did a shorter period was so that we could try and have code enforcement reviewing who was trimming and making sure that they were following the proper trimming procedures, and he needed a shorter period, or it seemed logical for him to have a shorter period. But I thought we should discuss this because it's been brought up a couple times to me.
Okay. Thank you, Michelle. I think a motion to discuss would be in order. Do we have a motion to open discussion?
So moved.
Alderman Barrier has made a motion to open discussion. Thank you, Alan. Do we have a motion?
Second.
Second. Alderman Simpson has seconded the motion. We're now open to discussion of our tree trimming permit fees and permit period.
Mayor.
Alan.
Michelle, you didn't talk anything. Are you comfortable with the fee? You have it in your headline as fees and time frame, but you didn't say anything about fees.
No, that's true. And we can discuss that as well. I did not have anyone complaining about the fee if the time for trimming was lengthened. So if we did it at like $35 for the whole summer season and $35 for the winter season, or for the whole year, that was fine. But if we're gonna do it for 10 days, then people felt it should be less. But the majority of people that I talked to would like it to just be longer.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor.
Mike.
I have received complaints that $35 for citizens is too high. And so I would like to see consideration of lowering it for residents. Keeping it at $35 for tree trimming services is fine with me, but the idea is to raise awareness of oak wilt, and I don't think we need to go that high for citizens.
Absolutely,
or residents.
Absolutely agree with you on the awareness standpoint. And I believe at one point our city attorney advised us that rules that apply to citizens are the same that apply commercially. So, you know, the idea that we would set a fee for our citizens and a different fee for our commercial ventures, the reason that we got to $35 was actually because we had been advised that we couldn't have a $5 fee for our citizens and a $50 fee for the commercial people. Charlie, is that your recollection of the facts, or am I just making that up out of whole cloth?
I don't recall saying that, but I can say this, that fees, as sort of back to a previous conversation, they can't be revenue generators. So the fee has to be in proportion to the cost to the city in administering whatever the fee is, the permittance fee is for. There is some authority to have some different fees for residents than there are for non-residents, for example.
Yeah, but so, these aren't non-residents. This is residents, and residents are paying a pass-through to a commercial entity.
No, I realize that, and that's a valid point. If you set two different fees, one for commercial and one for residents, the commercial person's just going to pass that increased cost onto their resident. But I think that generally speaking, it's been my experience that it costs more to administratively handle those commercial permits than it does residential permits. So there's a justification there.
Okay. Okay, now, yes, Mike, I'm sorry, please.
Bill, how much, how many of the permits are inspected in the field by code compliance?
Well, as many as we can, we attempt to go by there. I would say that having a 10-day period and having the idea that that's going to then generate a specific request versus our code enforcement officer driving through there and complying to see whether they have, I mean, it's more of that. I mean, there's sometimes daily checks, sometimes multiple checks. Most of the labor is done with commercials, because if I'm a resident and I want to cut a couple limbs, I go out there with my, you know, my pole saw, and I cut it and I put it up, and it takes me a few minutes, and I have a permit and I have awareness, and it's not a lot of cost. If I have a big project and I have to have a tree trimmer come in, it could take all day. And so multiple visits to make sure that they're cutting it right, painting it right, doing those things. I could easily argue we put a lot more effort into the commercial tree trimming. And also, I've talked to residents, you know, and they only want to cut a limb or two down a weekend, and it doesn't make sense for them to get a tree permit this week, and then next month they get another month, and then next month they get another one, when they're only cutting far less tree limbs than probably we would envision. So I think there's a lot of flexibility, and this is a good item that I think needs to be reviewed. I support this 100%.
Yeah. Okay. Now, the question comes back to, is this adopted by an ordinance to where we're going to have to send it to council, which city manager, or is this an administrative practice that he can act on at this time with a, and this is an action item, but we cannot enact ordinances at this meeting. Is this an administrative action that we can give Bill direction to now? Bill?
Yeah, you can give me direction to review the fee permits and the periods, and then that's all established in the permitting section, okay, which needs to be revised. And that would need to come up forward as an amendment to the ordinances.
Can we give you direction that for permits issued between now and the end of September, that those permits will go, if somebody comes in tomorrow, that they can go through the end of September?
I don't believe so. And I don't know, our practice has been 10 days, and I'm not sure, Mayor Pro Tem, how you got that. I've been in favor of extended seasons, and we have different people. When the permit clerk's there, other people fill in. I don't know what occurred. And I may find out tomorrow that we're actually doing that a lot more. So, you know.
I have one that says end of September.
Okay. Okay. So I would entertain a motion from council to direct the city manager to review the permitting fees and to create an appropriate permitting period.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Motion from Alderman Ross. Thank you, Michelle. Thank you, Mike, for your second. Is there any further discussion?
No.
If there's no further discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Item 614, let's...
I'd like to make a point of order and move up from the consent agenda 8.9 and 8.10 to be discussed now, because
okay,
we have guests.
Mayor, I'm moving to table 614 anyway.
Okay, we have a motion to table, which supersedes all other action. Do I have a second on the motion to table? And let me ask you when you're at your motion to table too.
The 6.14 PEG funds. You're asking to move the discussion up?
Yes.
So I was just going to tell everyone that I'm moving to table 6.14 because...
Until you bring it back to council.
Right, because we're waiting on some additional information from TMI.
Just wanted to clarify that.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a motion to postpone until Alderman Heisel brings item 6.14 back to council. Do I have a second?
Second.
Alderman Simpson has seconded the motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, the motion carries. I'm now going to recognize Alderman Ross for a procedural motion to move forward items 8.9 and 8.10 from the consent agenda. I'm going to recognize you for that motion. Okay, you've made the motion. Now, okay. Do I have a second on moving those forward?
Second.
Okay, all in favor of accepting the proposal, the procedural change, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. We are now going to move to item 8.9 and 8.11. We'll entertain 8.9 first. Approval, final plat of Napier Park, Unit 1, a 2.25-acre tract of land out of a 289.5-acre tract of land in the Refugio Vargas Survey Number 80, Abstract Number 781 in County Block 4787.
So, Mayor, it's 8.9 and 8.10, not 8.9 and 8.11. Just...
Oh, 8.9 and 8.10, yes. Okay, do I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
I have a motion to approve. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries. 8.10, approval final plat of Napier Park, Unit 2, a 1.961-acre tract of land out of a 289.5-acre tract out of the Refugio Vargas Survey Number 80, Abstract Number 781, City County Block 4787. I believe that that is just County Block 4787. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Alderman Ross and Alderman Heinzelman have made the motion and the second. Bob made the second. If there's no further discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. The motion carries. Sorry, gentlemen, to keep y'all so late. We're going to return to item 7, City Manager's Report. All matters listed under this item are considered routine by the City Council and will be considered at the request of one or more aldermen, which I assume includes the mayor. Coincident with each listed item, discussion will briefly occur. I'm going to request that the building permit activity report be pulled for brief discussion. Are there any other items?
I'd like to pull the police department activity report.
And to pull item 4.7. Okay, Bill, on the building permit activity report, I know that there is a significant project that has been undertaken in Shavano Park, and I did not see it on the permit. I did not see amount commensurate with that as a permitting fee come in during the month. Could you give me some clarification on that?
I think you're talking about Lock Hill Ventures, are also known as Nooners. So, just an update associated with that. I can tell you that in late July, Sean Nooner contacted the city and said that they were proceeding forward with the construction of their convenience store with car wash and gas sales. Shortly after he submitted application permit, very similar to the plans that had been done previous. I have consulted with the attorney in terms of how to proceed associated with that. Everyone knows that there's ongoing litigation, which is in various states of that. Guidance that I've received was to proceed with permitting as I would any other permit. A permit has been reviewed. It was sent back and resubmitted. And then last week, final approvals were gained from the building official and the fire marshal. Subsequent to that, the city approved that permit, and that permit stands as approved. It's not reflected in this report. I will tell you that shortly afterwards, or actually concurrent with that, the construction screening was in place around the property. They moved a bulldozer in there, I think a backhoe and a connex of some sort of building. Today they were installing silt screening associated with that. I don't have a specific timeline associated with how long that's going to proceed.
Okay, thank you, Bill. That was a little bit more than I was looking for in the scope of this item, but thank you for the further clarification for all of us concerning how the property is coming forward. And I'm assuming that all of that is simply in the ordinary course of business for the city, and that this was handled no differently than any other permitting. Which brings us to Michelle. Michelle?
I'd just like a clarification on the police activity report. We had a town hall meeting over the weekend, and it was brought to our attention by a resident that the police reports do not reflect vandalism of mailboxes and such in areas of the city. Is this true? Is that not included in the reports?
I think the answer to that is not detailed as a separate item. Do we include it in theft at all?
No.
Well, why wouldn't we include it if it was required a police call and it was an incident?
That particular classification is reported to the federal government. Federal government is the only one that can prosecute that, so they carry that.
Okay, but wouldn't we put that in the report as an incident that happened in our city?
So we need to do that. So, again, I got some feedback from the town hall. I talked to the police chief today about that. He just told me the same thing, but it's an ongoing trend of mailbox thefts. In fact, I was in Shavano Creek today, and I was talking to some folks that were concerned about oak trees and oak wilt, and one guy I'd never met before said, hey, you know, we had two packages stolen from our mailbox on Saturday. We know that because the FedEx tracking showed it arriving at 1 o'clock in the mailbox. By 5 o'clock when we were there, it was empty. So again, probably more than you're asking, but we are in contact with the postmaster. I have directed the police chief to actually write a letter not only to the postmaster in this region, but the postmaster general and large. This is a systemic problem across the city, and it has to do everything with the security of the hard security of the boxes themselves can be easily pried through. The locks apparently can be, you know, reportedly, and I don't know whether this is true, can be stolen, then a key made out of it. I've heard some of that stuff. But ultimately, you know, the U.S. Postmaster has a problem, and I think we need to highlight it and demand that they resolve it instead of just investigating time and time again.
And while I appreciate that, my question is, why don't we have that in the police report that we get monthly? We should have a section that shows that we have that incident. I mean, I understand if somebody tells you and they don't bother calling the police, then it's not recorded, but if the police are called out because there's some sort of vandalism or incident or whatever, it should always be recorded in our reporting.
Yeah, I agree with that. And, you know, again, the chief and I talked about adopting that in our in our reporting.
Thank you.
Okay. Does anybody else have an item that they would like to direct to the city manager or the police chief concerning item 7.4? Okay. Item 8, the consent agenda, all matters listed under this item are considered routine by the City Council and will be enacted by one motion. There will not be separate discussions on these items. If discussion is desired by any alderman on any item, that item will be removed from the comment agenda and will be considered separately. Do I have a motion to consider items 8.1 through 8.8 and item 8.1.1 through 8.1? Through 8.1.4.
Mr. Mayor.
8.1.4. Yes.
I would like to pull 8.2.
Okay, 8.2 is removed.
Okay. Otherwise, I would so move.
Okay, we have a motion to approve on the consent agenda items, item 8.1, 8.3 through 8.8, 8.11 through 8.14. Do I have a second?
Second.
So. Michelle has seconded the motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, same sign. The motion carries. We are now back to item 8.11, which has been removed from the consent agenda.
Actually, it was 8.2.
8.2, I'm sorry, 8.2.
And I would move that we amend the first line of item 5.1 to insert parenthetical 0.294780 per 100 immediately following the effective tax rate on the first line item of the item, so that 5.1 would read as amended. Mayor Pro Tem Ross made a motion to propose to adopt the effective tax rate parent dollar 0.294780 per 100 close parent or lower, end quote.
Okay, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
So moved.
We have a second. Now we're now open for discussion. Michelle, this was your motion. So we're going to come back and let you discuss it.
Oh, I don't care. I mean, I explained it in the meeting that the reason that I made the motion for what it was so that we didn't have to do public hearings, and I expected the rate to be less. And I also said after I made the motion that the rate would be no higher, from my opinion, of the current rate we carried this year. So maybe we should add that as well.
Okay, are you making a motion to amend?
Yes.
Okay. I need to know what you're making the motion to amend to say.
To clarify that in addition to that motion, I also included.
Okay, now, I need the words. I understand what you just said. Zena, I need for you to read back Alderman Simpson's motion, the interlineation that has been made, the addition that he is proposing, and then we're going to come in and you're going to tell us what you want to add. I apologize, but I want to make sure that we get it specifically, okay? Okay.
That's fine. I don't care.
Okay, now that was not your motion.
I said or, and, well.
Yeah, I know, but or lower. That was, you know, your
That's
motion.
Fine.
Okay. And the minutes are to reflect the action of the board as opposed to the, and I respect Alderman Simpson on his clarification of the motion, but that was not your motion. Your motion was as stated by Zena because she took copious notes to get it down the first time. Okay, so you're going to withdraw your motion
Yes.
to amend. Okay, we have a motion and a second to amend the special city council meeting minutes for August 11, 2016. There being no further discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. The motion carries, which brings us to item 9.
Mr. Mayor, I have a point of order or information. I'm not sure which. If we refer to the July 25th minutes that we've just approved, item 6.6, the council approved a motion to adopt a policy requiring all committees or subcommittees of the City Council, Planning and Zoning Commission, Water Board, or any other municipal board, corporation, or commission to post notice of meetings and conduct its meetings in a location open to the general public. That motion carried.
And
tonight, the implementing resolution was voted down. So where do we stand as far as, I would assume that what Bill needs to do is go back and take another shot at a resolution because the council has previously approved this action. What is your ruling as to where we stand administratively with that motion that was approved and now the resolution itself, the implementing resolution that wasn't approved?
Yeah, and Mike, you might recall that at the time, Alderman Barrier had a question and said, well, when is this effective? And the ruling from the chair was that it is effective upon adoption of a policy. The policy has not been adopted. The policy has failed. And I believe that we will have to bring it back to City Council, to the city manager, because the policy failed. Unless you're telling me that the policy did not state your intention. If you're telling me that the city manager prepared the policy incorrectly, then I will ask that with unanimous consent that we return it to the city manager for further delineation in a way that accurately describes the intention of the body.
Well, and as I voted for the resolution, I think you'd have to ask one of the three nays what their intent was with that vote, because I don't know where we are administratively, because we've got the city council voting for something, an implementing policy coming back.
Yeah.
It was voted down. So does that mean that he needs to take another shot at it, or is the issue closed?
But I believe that the council has voted to against the policy is what I believe. Mm-hmm. And the reason that I believe that is because all policies are conditioned upon adopting a formal resolution by the city council.
Okay.
If y'all want to bring it back next month, we certainly entertain it as another motion. You know, but that's the difficulty that we always have any time that we're adopting a policy on the fly. And that's one of the reasons why I believe council has wisely decided that if we're going to adopt a policy, that we have a written policy that we are formally adopting instead of saying, well, come back to us and tell us what we adopted after the fact. Well, that has been the practice of this council when I was not on council, you know, and so I'm just following the precedent that we previously set forth.
Okay, but that policy was in the packet when we adopted it in July. It was not in resolution form, but okay, I'll let it die here.
Okay. Okay, did I address your procedural question?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Alderman Ross has made the motion. Alderman Barrier seconded the motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. The motion carries.